to conduct these services. Just for information, the family prayer was offered by Edmund Peterson. We will next have an invocation given by Susan Checkitz, and we will go to that point.
Dear Heavenly Father, we gather today in this memorial service to celebrate the life of Lindsay Peterson. Heavenly Father, we are so grateful for the plan, that we know that there is a plan and that life is eternal through our Savior Jesus Christ. Heavenly Father, we are grateful that we were able to know Lindsay. He was fun and had a heart of gold and would do anything for anybody. Left us with many great memories. We pray, Heavenly Father, that thy spirit will be here, that thy loving arms will gather those that are in mourning at this time, and that they can be comforted and feel thy spirit. We're so grateful for the gospel, for the knowledge that we have. We pray that we will do well, look for ways to help one another, and we pray for thy spirit to be here and comfort those that need it this day, and that those that are participating will have thy spirit to be with him. This we pray and thank thee for all we have in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. Amen.
Okay, so the rest of our services will go as follows. First, we'll have an obituary tribute given by Cami Michelli, a musical selection by Risa James and Peggy Wilwright, and then a speaker, Mamie Peterson. Another musical selection by Joshua James, and then I will get up and give some closing remarks.
I have to tell you, this is tough. Being up here in front of all these people, both my brother and being at home. I thank you all for coming to love and support our family. As you honor my brother, you honor my mom, you honor us. Lindsay, Lenny P. Buzz made his early exit January 29th, 2022. And the professionals say it was COVID, but now his 40th birthday was coming up, and he sure did miss my mom. I was 11 years old when Lindsay was born. He had a pretty traumatic entry into this world, and he came out, he was all bright red, and he had these bumps all over his head, and he was not a cute baby. I wasn't quite sure what to think of him, but within a few days, he totally changed, and he ended up being the cutest thing that I'd ever seen. And I kind of felt like he was my own, and I made it a goal that I would try to teach him and try to save him and shelter him from some of the cruelty in our lives. My mom and Evan both worked. I babysat a lot. I remember trying to teach him how to pull faces, and he finally got it, and I laughed so hard, and then every time he would do it, he'd laugh really hard. My mom would get furious because he'd be sitting in the high chair and she'd be trying to feed him, and he'd start. She'd be like, what did you do that for? What'd you teach him how to do that for? Lynn's first brush with death happened when he was about three. He was playing in the car in the driveway. My mom's driveway was kind of steep, and then it went right across the road and dropped off into the river. And I remember being out in the yard and seeing the car go. He was playing in the car, and he must have popped it into neutral or something. And everybody just ran. I know I ran as fast as I could. We were like, holy cow. And Lindsay was standing up on the front seat of the car. We all saw him holding on to the steering wheel as the car went across the road and then dropped over the cliff. And we all ran across the road after him. And I don't know how every single one of us saw that exact same thing, but when we turned around, Lindsay was sitting in the middle of the road. It wasn't his time. Lindsay and I started spending a lot more time together when I was a teenager. I had a driver's license. No matter how tight his bond was with my mom, he drove her crazy. He was extremely hyper, so he was always with me, and I wanted him to be with me. He'd always tell me, remember when we did this? Remember when we went here? Do you remember when you used to bribe me with a sucker all the time? Do you remember when you used to listen to this song over and over and over as loud as you could? That I remember. And so I want to take a little bit of credit for his decent taste in music, and probably a little for his hearing loss. He was 8 when I left Barrow City the first time. And although I didn't see him every single day like I did before, him and Mamie had their fair share of sleepovers at my house. And 4 years later, when my pops died, I moved back to Barrow City to take care of my grandma. And one day, Ed and I took the family to Newton Dam for a picnic. And of course, Lindsay went. He wanted to race me across the dam, swimming. I said, all right, so we'd swim across the dam, and I beat him. So he wanted to do it again, so we did it again. 4 or 5 times later, he still hasn't beaten me, and he's like, come on, do it again, let's do it again, let's do it again. I'm like, I'm exhausted. I can't do this again, I'm exhausted. Give me a minute, we'll do it again later. Well, he goes out, he's still full of energy, so he goes out, he starts swimming across, and he gets about halfway across and he goes under, and he comes back up, and he goes under, and he doesn't come up. And I swam as fast and as hard as I could. I made it to him, and I dove down, and I got him, and I started swimming back with him, and he started laughing, and I tried to drown him. The other couple times that Lindsay almost met death were at the hands of my mother. I don't know how many times I saw her chase him, and all we could ever think was, holy cow, what'd that kid do now? Lindsay spent the first half of his life terrorizing the streets of Bear River City, and then he moved to Twin Falls, but he always came back to Bear River to see his lifelong friends, and he always talked about them. I think he was 17 the first time that he came to live with me in Twin. Lori and I were painting my apartment, and somebody came over, somebody called. Lindsay had been in an accident. Him and Jared had been riding the pedal bikes down the road, and the front tire of Lindsay's bike came off, and he met the curb with his face. Broke off his teeth and shoved some up clear into his gums. It was pretty brutal. Well, Lori and I immediately, you know, all they said was, Lindsay's in an accident, he wants you to come and get him. The vet that was by Skateland. I'm like, the vet? Why did he go to the vet? So Lori and I jump in the car. We don't even have shoes on. We've got paint all over us. Jump in the car, go get him. He is a mess, and he's, you know, through blood and snot and pain, he's yelling at me, what took you so long? Why did it take you so long? I'm like, I don't even have shoes on, and I'm covered in paint, and we just, whatever. So we're driving down the road. Lori's driving because I'm a mess. I'm freaking out that Lindsay's hurt. Lori's driving. She's speeding like 75 in a 30-mile-an-hour zone through Twin Falls. Got the flashers, hazards going, and we get pulled over. Because apparently it's illegal to have your hazards on when you're driving down the road like that, and it's not actually, I don't know. So we get pulled over, and Lindsay the whole time, he's, don't stop, Cam, don't stop, just keep going, don't stop, don't stop. I don't remember anything that happened at the hospital, but I remember his recovery over the coming weeks and how rough it was. The second time that he come to stay with me in Twin Falls, you know, he was a young kid. He was 17, 18 years old, and he was helping me. I was a single mom, and I tried to let him have as much freedom as he could have and still be a kid while trying to figure out how to be an adult. And I'd let him use my car. I'd tell him, yeah, you're okay. And I was telling Jeremy the other day, you know, should have never put a teenage boy in a midlife crisis sports car because I know he drove it like he stole it. And Jeremy said, oh yeah. Oh yeah, we did. Lynn lived life on his own terms, unless the Department of Fish and Wildlife or Corrections told him otherwise. He loved to hunt and fish, and he'd do it with anyone that wanted to join him, regardless of licensure or property lines. He also loved to drive. He loved to drive anything with wheels, anything with tracks, and that's generally where he found himself in trouble. He was larger than life, with a contagious smile, a hearty laugh, and a wicked sense of humor. You could always count on Lindsay for a good story, accompanied by full character impressionist acting. And I'm sure every single one of you has seen the full character, just like the rest of us. He talks with his body and with his hands. He'd tell you about catching the biggest trout ever recorded at the Honeyville Pond, or finally getting that buck with a record-breaking spread, and you'd know that it was exaggerating. He told some big tales, you'd just know he was exaggerating. And then you'd read, you know, read the article in the paper and be like, oh, he was totally telling the truth. My relationship with Lindsay has been strained over the last few years. He told me a few times that he wanted to be the old Lindsay, to be my Lindsay, but he wasn't. Or maybe he was, and the rest of us had just changed. And I kind of think that. I think he was the same Lindsay, and the rest of us just grew up and moved on. But I wish that I would ever have such high expectations of him, because I think maybe that was a lot of pressure. I wish I could have accepted him for exactly who he was and loved him. I couldn't. There's no way that I could love Lindsay anymore, but I could have loved him more often. He loved his family, his friends, music, and Jim, sorry. He's survived by his dad, Evan, the three crazy sisters, Debbie, Cammie, and Mamie. Let's make an announcement. Everybody keeps asking me, is that your sister? That's my sister, Debbie. She's a year older than me. Just get that out of the way. His niece, Harmony, Danny, nephew, Travis, his fiancée, Jen, many cousins whom he loved, his siblings. He and Mamie were really close over the last few years. He relied on her a lot, but he loved her and he always will. And Link, Jeremy and Caitlin, he never, ever once referred to you as his cousins. You were always his brothers. Lindsay was preceded in death by her mom, Carol Linda Hall Peterson. Their bond was great, and he was often seen with her urn, taking her. See, I told you I was going to blow a snot in front of everybody. Oh my gosh. Lindsay would show up at my house, and I'd ask him, "What are you doing?" "Oh, I'm just taking mom for a drive. Thought she'd like some sunshine today." All right. But that was part of his grieving process. My relationship with my mom was very different than the ones that she had with Lindsay and Mamie. And sometimes we were like feuding sisters, but we loved each other. And we did have some good times. I remember my mom coaching softball. She loved softball. And Mamie gets that from her, so Lindsay. And I remember a car full of girls in the winter. I don't know what we were doing, but there was a lot of snow, and my mom, just a few blocks this way, my mom pulled right up in all the snow, right up to Jenny Anderson's front door, and let her out. And we laughed. We laughed so stinking hard. I remember Lori and I going to a concert and my mom letting us use the car to drive to Salt Lake. And I don't know if either one of us even had a license. But we took the car. She gave us the car and a present and a note to be safe. You know, my mom always felt the need to do good for other people. She wanted to help other people. I don't know if she knew how to always help herself. She was hilarious at times. I've been told I laugh like her. We spent a lot of time together the last few years of her life, and we talked like we were very old friends. And ultimately, she did the best that she could in life. And that's what we all do, is the best that we can. I'm comforted knowing that my mom's going to have a permanent resting place. And I'm soothed knowing that she's going to be with my brother. And she'll be close to my folks here in Bear River City. Thank you. This community of Bear River City, no matter how many years I stay away, Bear River City will always be my home. And I thank everyone in this community for coming together and doing this for my family. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. probably the hardest thing that anyone has to do. My brother Lindsay was always the life of the party. He made everyone laugh even when he wasn't trying to be funny. He had a big heart and wore his heart on his sleeve. Lindsay was one of the strongest people I've ever known. He climbed many mountains and endured many hardships. He tried his best. I was very proud of my brother and his recent goals for the future. Lindsay was very protective of the ones he loved, and I knew that he always had my back. Lindsay taught me so much. He taught me how to play basketball, and I must say, I became quite good. He taught me how to tie a hook the proper way, and how to hook the big ones. He taught me how to shoot a gun, and the first time I fired a shotgun, I fell on my butt, and he just laughed so hard at me. These are just a few things Lindsay taught me, but the most important thing he taught me was how to be strong. When we were kids, I had to go wherever my brother went. I hated when he would go hang out with his friends without me. Our mom would make him take me with most of the time. My brother and I would often go fishing at Honey Blue Pond. He loved that pond and always knew how to catch our limit. I'll never forget the day that Lindsay and his buddies went fishing at Honey Blue Pond and pulled in the grandpa fish. It was huge. They had to walk across the street in Honeyville and use some stranger's phone to call my mom to come get them because they pulled in that big fish. Lindsay was so proud, and he never forgot about that. One time while fishing the Devil's Creek, Lindsay bet me $20 that I could cast farther than him, and I accidentally hooked a duck. I was freaking out so bad, so he reeled in the duck. And when our mom saw what was going on, she was like, "Lindsay, what did you do this time?" I was like, "It was me, Mom." She's like, "Yeah, right, you know." But luckily, the hook was barely in one of the feathers, so, you know, the duck got away unharmed. My brother is definitely the reason why I'm so competitive, and I'm not really scared of a lot of things, and that's because of him. Lynn was full of life and wasn't scared of anything but spiders. I hated them. I'll never forget looking out from the front yard of our old house in Bear River out to the Holmgren's racetrack and seeing Lindsay jumping my dad's red Chevy on all those jumps and seeing the red truck go flying in the air. He was an adventurer and never, ever took life for granted. And I hope none of us ever take it for granted. I love you, Lynn, and I'm going to miss you. I'm not going to miss you catching more fish than me. No, I am. We went out to Salmon Dam one time. We took it, I think he borrowed a boat. I think it was Lincoln's maybe. We went out there, and it's always windy out there. And I didn't catch one dang fish, and Lindsay's reeling in all these fish like every 30 seconds. And I was just so mad. Like, this is bull crap. I'm never going again, you know. But he was the best. I'm gonna miss him. And while I'm here, I want to say a few words about my mom. She was my best friend, my inspiration. She was full of life and love. Loved her girls, Cassie, Natalie, all of y'all. Wednesday got his heart from my mom. She had a heart of gold. And I think he got his competitive, well, both of my parents are pretty competitive, so he got his good looks from both of them too. I prepared a song to sing for my brother.
God be with him till we meet again. By his counsel's guide and holy, where the sheep securely fold.
Each of us can benefit from that. says, "And again, I exhort you, my brethren, that ye deny not the gifts of God, for they are many, and they come from the same God. And there are many different ways that these gifts are administered, but it is the same God who worketh all in all, and they are given by manifestation of the Spirit of God unto men to profit them." So I absolutely know that no matter what we are all going through, the hardships, the heartache, whatever it may be, these gifts of God are there for us. If we will reach out to Him, that we can be comforted. And I'll leave that with you in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. Our benediction will now be offered by Natalie Cutler. The interment will be over at the Bearable City Cemetery. And just for your information, the pallbearers are Jeremy Peterson, Aaron Checkets, Clay Holmgren, Kaylin Peterson, Justin Hansen, Gordon Holmgren, Shane Fontbeck, Lincoln Peterson, Jacob Mondragon, and Nick Peterson.
Congregation, please rise.